Good morning. We have general questions. Question number one. In the name of Rhoda Grant, has not been lodged. The member has provided an explanation. Question number two, Neil Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it considers the Lobbying Scotland Bill fit for purpose.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Yes.
Neil Findlay.
Thanks for that detailed answer. Has the Minister heard of such radical new technology as the telephone, conference calls, computers and email? And if so, why are these methods of communication not included in the lobbying bill and it's only face-to-face communications?
Minister.
Thank you. Well, the government has sought to introduce a proportionate bill that balances the legitimate interests of Parliament, the public and wider society. It's widely recognised that face-to-face meetings with ministers and MSPs are seen as the most effective and influential means of communication. It's important to consider carefully whether any extension of the scope of the register would continue to be proportionate, simple, not place a burden on organisations and, I think, very importantly, not potentially lead to a barrier to the openness of this Parliament and the public's desire to engage in democracy.
Cameron Buchanan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is vital in a democracy the public are able to address their concerns to their elected representatives. What assurances can the Scottish Government give that this bill will not compromise accessibility?
Minister.
I think the member makes an interesting point, and it's about balance. So we've tried to bring forward a bill which is proportionate and balanced, and therefore will increase transparency while not eroding that important openness which this Parliament cherishes so much. So it's about getting balance. So if there were proposals to extend the bill further, then I think it would be very important that those proposals were examined very carefully to make sure it was not impacting on that openness of this Parliament.
Annabel Goldie.
Sorry, I wasn't proposing to come in.
That's fine, you can sit down again. I'll call you when you want to come in. Question number three, John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with First Group concerning the proposed closure of the Parkhead bus depot and the potential for redundancies or job transfers.
Minister Derek Mackay.
As it happens, I visited First Caledonian Depot on Tuesday and was impressed at the substantial investment that's been made in what is now the biggest bus depot in Britain. First explained that they're discussing with staff how they can best use this investment to improve staff facilities across Glasgow. I understand that First Glasgow's business director, John Cahill, has written to the member confirming that there would be no redundancies arising from the closure and offering a meeting to discuss the situation in more detail with Mr Mason.
John Mason.
I thank him for that answer. I mean, I just wonder if he would agree with me that First Bus have been particularly poor at communicating both with the public and with some of their employees, and there remains concern in the east end of Glasgow about the impact on jobs and on bus services.
Minister.
Mr Mason takes such matters very seriously. I also know that the First Group have gone beyond their legal obligations. It is about being proportionate. I am advised that First consulted through a formal letter to the three Unite conveners in First Glasgow, followed by a formal presentation to the Joint Consultative Committee. I know they said they've gone beyond those requirements. They've been clear about no redundancies, and I'm sure that reassurance is very welcome. And in terms of the condition of the Parkhead depot, it is a 93-year-old building. Therefore, the changes that are made, the investments that are made, of course, I would encourage good communication with the staff, because this should be a positive move from the operator that can improve facilities and, in due course, the wider transport network in that area.
Question number four, Ken McIntosh.
To ask the Scottish Government how the reduction in its overall funding over the last 7 years compares with that for local government.
Minister Marco Biaggi.
No part of the public sector in Scotland has been immune to the UK Government's sustained austerity programme. But despite real-term cuts of around 9% to the Scottish budget over the last 5 years, Scotland's local authorities have been treated very fairly under this administration and protected from the worst of the impact of the UK cuts. Complexities over the machinery of government changes make accurate time series comparisons problematic. For example, the Scottish Government has taken on responsibility for council tax benefit, and a true comparison of local government funding over the last 7 years is not straightforward due to the transfer of responsibility for the police and fire services. Our best estimate of a like-with-like comparison shows that local government funding has reduced by 3.5% in real terms over the period, compared to the Scottish Government's DEL plus non-domestic rates income budget reducing by 4.5%.
Okay, Macintosh.
I'm interested by the Government's figures. Perhaps he should consult with Spice, because they've done a similar calculation and they were able to work out our estimate that the Scottish Government's funding has declined by 3% in real terms, but that local government has suffered a 6% real terms cut. So, in other words, a double of the cut has been passed to the Scottish Government. Perhaps more important, looking forward, we know that the Scottish Government, the settlement for Scotland is not going to be good. Can I ask the Minister if he will guarantee our local authority colleagues that they will be able to protect public services and care for the elderly and those with disabilities, because he will not pass on in real terms any more than is inflicted on him?
Minister.
The Scottish Government is in extensive discussions with COSLA at this point, going over the spending review and the proposed settlement for local government, so it's, this is an ongoing point of discussion. I would, however, suggest to Ken Macintosh that if he really does want to see what local government being cut looks like, that he go to just across the border, just a few stops on the East Coast Main Line, and he would see what happens when governments don't try to protect local government, when ideological attacks are taken.
Yeah. Okay, and just looking, let's hear the Minister.
And looking at the last IFS analysis of the last UK government budget, it found reductions of 27.4% by the UK government to English local authorities, and that only got worse in the last announcement on November 25th. So I would just say to Ken Macintosh to realise just how much this government is doing everything it can to protect local government, especially when all of those cuts do burn it over to our budget too.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, do you recall any time over the last 7 years Ken Macintosh contacting you with suggestions on those areas of the Scottish budget he wanted to cut in order to fund local government? And that given up until now the Scottish Government has had to operate within virtually a fixed but declining budget, do you agree that it is both cynical and disingenuous of opposition members to demand increased expenditure in one portfolio without clarifying exactly how they would pay for it with reductions in another?
Minister.
Well, I do note that Ken Macintosh has taken to the press to suggest that there should be £755 million more funding on local government. And this government is always open to suggestions from opposition parties. So I would simply invite anyone who thinks that funding should be increased to local government by £755 million to take the fag packet that was written on and write on the back how exactly that would be paid for, because that would be almost a 40% increase in council tax. And last I heard, although this does change a lot, the Labour Party was supporting the council tax freeze.
Question number five, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what the uptake of grants was from the Centenary Memorials Restoration Fund in 2014-15.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Grant funding of £224,000 and 370 was provided under the Centenary Memorials Restoration Fund to 28 projects in the 2014-15 financial year, bringing the total to over £500,000 and 67 projects since the scheme started.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that positive answer. In my constituency of Glasgow Annie'sland, as in all other constituencies across Scotland, there are a significant number of war memorials. Unfortunately, the poor condition of many of these is sadly plain for all to see. I believe we're all conscious of institutions such as schools, football, bowling and social clubs which have their own memorials. Can the Minister tell me what more the Scottish Government is doing to encourage these groups to take up the opportunity to apply for funding to upgrade these memorials?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the fund itself is £1 million from the period it was announced from 2013 to 2018. As I said, over £500,000 has already been allocated. Members can help promote schemes in their own area. I understand that there has been a visit to the Yokert Memorial by the Centenary Memorial Trust Conservation Officer, although there's not been an application made as yet from the member's own constituency. The grant is up to 75% of eligible costs, up to a maximum grant of £30,000, and we take every opportunity we can to promote such works and to have an opportunity for communities to make sure that their memorials are in a good state of repair. And I would encourage members across the chamber to look at what they can do in their own constituencies, and we as government will continue to promote it as we have been.
Question number six, Annabel Goldie.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what measures it will take to protect vulnerable people affected by the weather this winter.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
The Scottish Government has taken a range of measures to protect vulnerable people against the effects of weather this winter. Tackling fuel poverty remains a priority for this Government. This year, a record budget of £119 million is being made available for fuel poverty and energy efficiency, helping vulnerable groups stay warm. In November, we launched our 2015 Ready for Winter campaign to encourage people and communities to take simple steps to prepare for tough winter conditions. And our seasonal flu programme, launched on the 1st of October, offers free seasonal flu vaccination and will help to protect more than 2 million people, including vulnerable groups, from catching flu this winter. And of course, NHS boards have been working with their partners throughout the year to ensure that they have robust winter plans in place.
Annabel Goldie.
Presiding Officer, the national record of Scotland winter mortality in Scotland 2014-15 found that there were 22,011 deaths registered in Scotland in the 4 months of winter, December to March, compared with 18,675 in winter 2013-14. It's clear, with an ageing population with growing health problems, winter in itself is becoming a threat to good health. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me which of the measures she's just outlined she considers is most specifically targeted at that vulnerable group? And is she satisfied that all attempts have been taken, with the coldest winter predicted for many years, to support people who find themselves threatened by that challenge?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm sure the member will be aware of the Chief Medical Officer's interest in this matter, and indeed she was very engaged this week on looking at the analysis of the winter mortality figures and what lies behind those, and a lot of work has been done on that. I would say to the member that all of the measures that I outlined have a direct impact on protecting the most vulnerable, whether it be the board, the NHS board plans that they have in place in partnership with their local authority colleagues. And of course, this year, the plans are far more integrated than previously, involving social care colleagues in making sure that the most vulnerable can be supported during winter. And of course, the general Ready for Winter campaign has some very pertinent advice through the Ready Scotland website for how people can keep safe and warm at home, and the fuel poverty measures are of particular relevance to those who are the most vulnerable. I'm happy to write to Annabel Goldie if she would like any further information on that.
Question number seven, Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government when it last met with the South West of Scotland Transport Partnership and what issues were discussed.
Minister Derek Mackay.
My officials from Transport Scotland met with Swiss Trans last week to discuss local aspirations for the reopening of Beatuck station.
Lee Murray.
I'm delighted to hear that those discussions have taken place. The Minister will be aware, in fact, that there are community-led campaigns for the reopening of Beatuck, and also East Riggs, a halt at East Riggs and a station at Thornhill. Some years ago, the Scottish Government announced a stations fund for that purpose, and I wonder if you can give me some sort of progress report in terms of how far we are in the progress of reopening these stations.
Minister.
I've certainly recalibrated the stations fund to be focused on new stations where that's possible. There are a number of bids in the system at the moment, and any application for new stations would have to be considered through the due process of STAG, that's the appraisal for transport options, and other approaches by relevant promoters, be it local authorities or regional transport partnerships. And I'm happy to offer further support from officials to guide local communities through that process.
Question number 8, Joanne Lamont.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, Europe and External Affairs last met Creative Scotland and what issues were discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
I last met with the Chair of Creative Scotland, Richard Findlay, on the 12th of November when we discussed a number of issues of importance to arts and culture in Scotland, including BBC Charter Renewal and the Spending Review.
Joanne Lamont.
I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the fantastic campaign by the Remembering Mary Barber Association in my constituency, which seeks to create a permanent memorial to a remarkable woman of whom the people of Govan remain very proud. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my regret at the decision of Creative Scotland to reject an application for support for what is an exciting artistic project? Will she raise this disappointing response with Creative Scotland, and will she agree to meet with me and members of the Remembering Mary Barber campaign to explore how the Scottish Government could support this initiative to remember a hugely important woman in the history of Govan, Glasgow and beyond?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am aware of the campaign. I support the campaign. I think it's a very important initiative to give credence and support and memory to a very important campaigner at a very important time. However, what I would say is that I am frequently asked by members of the opposition to direct Creative Scotland to fund particular projects and not to then, on the other hand, have direct ministerial control of decisions that are taken. So in terms of agreeing to meet with the member, I'm more than happy to do that. But if she can understand that government itself doesn't support new memorials that tend to be funded by subscription, but what we can try and do to raise the profile of this initiative to help encourage that public subscription to that statue would be very important. But I can't interfere with individual parts on decision making for individual projects, but I'm happy to try and help Creative Scotland understand more about what the project is and the community engagement that is involved.
Question number 9, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Roberts.
Ministers and government officials regularly meet with representatives of all boards, including NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply, and I do warmly welcome the announcement made last week by the Deputy First Minister that the European funding classification issue has been finalised and that the new Inverclyde Care Home project can progress. And this is welcomed by many constituents. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide reassurances that the Inverclyde Royal Hospital has a sustainable future ahead of it and is firmly in the plans of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to provide services in Inverclyde for many years to come?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I also welcome the progress being made on the Inverclyde Care Home, and can I assure the member that Inverclyde Royal Hospital does indeed have a bright future? The hospital is a valued local facility and very much part of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's plans for the future, and I'm sure they would be happy to meet with Stuart McMillan to praise him of the plans for the hospital going forward.
Duncan McNeill.
During the Cabinet Secretary's meeting with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, did she discuss the Scottish Public Finances update, which of course brought to an end the unnecessary and distressing delay to the Ravenscraig Older Care Unit construction programme? Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that any increases due to increased construction costs will be met in full by the Scottish Government and ensure that there is no further unnecessary delay to this very important project in my constituency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is indeed a very important project in Duncan McNeill's constituency, and I'm glad that he welcomes the progress that is being made. He will be aware there is a robust financial plan around this project, and I would be happy to keep the member informed, but the robust financial planning around that will deliver this project on time and on budget.
Question 10, Cameron Buchanan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what is the average waiting time for GP referral is for elective surgery in the NHS Lothian.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
In the year ending the 30th of September 2015, the median waiting time in Lothian for a first outpatient consultation was 38 days and 42 days for inpatient and day case treatment.
Cameron Buchanan.
Thank you very much. I think it's simply not good enough when patients are left in the dark for very long periods when the next stage of treatment will be and what can be extremely distressing. What does the Scottish Government have to make use of the NHS consistently better informed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we would certainly expect all boards to make sure they deliver timely treatment for patients, and where there is any delay, for example, due to recruitment or retention issues, that they are communicating with patients and making sure they're fully informed of when their treatment can commence. If the member has any specific patient concerns around individuals, then I would be happy if he wanted to write to me with those, and I would be able to give him a fuller answer on the specific patient cases.
Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia.